and Bill.
Hi, Bill.
Hi, Bill.
So, what am I doing here?
Giving a talk.
Cryptography is really one of the things that made me fall in love with mathematics. And I don't want to say when that was, but it was like third grade. I found a book in the library.
When did you learn to read?
I remember the exact moment. My first grade teacher was my mother's carpool to the ladies' orchestra and sewing circle. And Dick and Jane suddenly made sense. But it's brilliant flesh.
My mom taught me to read before I even started kindergarten.
As did my wife's mother. They had a branch of the county library in their living room for their subdivision. Their town didn't have a library. Advantage of being a young man.
It kind of backfired on me. When they were trying to teach us to read in kindergarten, they'd go around like in a circle, and each person would read the sentence. When it came to my turn, I would fumble around and scroll back like 10 pages. Years later, when I saw my dad say it, they said, he's really slow, he can't seem to keep up.
Right. Uh-huh. Yep. Well, my daughter got in trouble for giving away the ending to Romeo and Juliet and reading in high school. Okay. I guess when they say there are cultural differences, they aren't kidding.
There's nothing worse than spoilers.
Yeah.
That's where we're starting with it.
Yeah. So, agenda tonight is kind of different than our usual agenda. After Q&A, which is item number 0, we'll do the crypto news and review, which is a double-year bundle because...
it's been 2 years.
Because I wasn't here last year. And then the main entree is the historical segment, which will be transposition ciphers in historic context. And then we'll do the reminder about how to do the key signing, and then we'll have the circular firing squad. That is the technical term, folks.
Right before we start that, of course, we need to turn off the tangler.
Yeah, you probably don't want to take that. Now, there's one item I should mention in addition to what's on the list, but the last couple of years, we've been in a cycle of branded vulnerabilities. If you have a punchy name and a logo, your vulnerability gets news coverage.
Oh, heart bleed.
Exactly. And everybody else had to do it. We had Shellshock, we had Poodle, we had Freak and Rowhammer. And most of these are way oversold. Heartbleed was actually bad.
Isn't that what led to the creation of Libre SSL?
Shellshock.
Yes.
Giving them names like that is giving undue glory to the doing it.
Exactly. Shellshock, well, yeah, maybe so. But most of these are, well, yeah, if you can find somebody running old ciphers, and you can trick them into doing something stupid, and you man in the middle of them, maybe you can hurt them. But, you know, all the more reasons to get rid of SSL v2 is good, but it is time to strand the IE6 users. Okay?
Screw what users?
Internet Explorer.
I got you, IE6, yeah.
Yeah. If they can't use TLS 1.1, then they can't connect to you, that's fine. But there is one recent hash collision that is interesting for our PGP key signing. Somebody put up a forged key on the key server where they had the same fingerprint as an email address, or at least a lookalike email address. For the target of the exploit. So it is possible to get collisions on the key fingerprints. Difficult. And this is why in the instructions that Jabber has posted on the website, or will have in a few minutes, he posts it every year, we do no longer say you should post the signed key back to the key server you pulled the key down from.
Yeah, we haven't been doing that for years.
We haven't been doing that for years. We were ahead of the game on this one. That's good. You will sign it, encrypt it with the key that you just signed, and send it back to the person at the email address they claim to control. Then they have to control that to get it, and they have to have that key to get it.
And what important point, though.
And then they can merge all the signatures, and they're happy. But they aren't on the key server, so that we're not encouraging anybody to rely upon it.
One important point to bring up here. A number of years ago, I wrote a script to sort of semi-automate the key sign process. And as was pointed out earlier, here like half hour ago, there's a recurring called CAFF, C-A-F-F. It's in the Debian and the Fedora repos. And that does the same thing as my script and a lot more. It's much better to use that one than the one that I wrote. So if you read the instruction on the website before I update it, don't use my script, use the CAFF script.
Okay. I like your script, but I'll try the CAFF script.
I believe kind of the CAFF script looks a lot like mine, but it also does a whole lot of other things.
One paper that recently came out that was interesting, somebody grabbed all of the public keys they could find on the internet and looked at them statistically and managed to figure out, for most of them, what algorithm created it, and therefore they can categorize if a certain algorithm is found to generate weak keys, a third of the time, a tenth of the time, whatever, then they can categorize which keys might be vulnerable. So that your key leaks how it was created just by its very existence, because people use different ranges of primes. If you like that kind of number theory, the million key question is a great paper to look at, and it's got really nice visualizations. Rowhammer looked like a total, yeah, that's cute, lab paper. Somebody's come up with something that's called flip feng shui, which is apparently weaponizing it. Amazing.
The thing with Rowhammer, though, is I heard that like block bumping, the better the memory is, the easier it is to Rowhammer. So one good thing is that, like with Amazon, we're really like your big VPS is where you're really going to be doing it. Amazon probably is not buying the best memory; they're probably more buying the
budget
memory. So since they're buying budget memory, you actually have a slight reprieve on it. But
maybe.
That's the hope.
So anyway, that's the news from Lake Wobegon.
Yeah, I just have one thing about CAFF. CAFF is Debian only.
No.
It's not?
No.
It's in Fedora.
Not in the repos. What repos?
Sure, pgp-tools.
Pgp-tools? Okay.
Yep.
Useful information, but we'll...
I'll have to install the repo.
We can discuss that further when we get to the how-to.
Okay.
So much for the appetizer. We're doing transposition ciphers in historic context, but we'll also have codes.
I was a little bit curious about whether you were going to say anything in the history about how, I jumped ahead another page. I'm not sure if you want
to. Yeah. So
I was curious if you were going to say anything about the newfangled elliptic curves that
nope.
They're trying to get at.
Nope.
They are
nope.
Also
elliptic curves are not history, they're new. Elliptic curves are good stuff as long as you don't use the NSA's curve.
Yes.
You use Bernstein's curve and pick your own point.
Yeah. NSA, oh. The only agency in the government that really listens.
Yeah. And of course, they've also promised.
Unless, of course, you're required to use the NSA curve, then use it.
Yes.
But I'll bet if you're doing classified work, they require a different curve than the one they gave in ISD.
Yeah. However, and there is also they are promising to release their suite of cryptographic algorithms that they believe are resistant to quantum cryptography.
That would be nice. Quantum cryptography is, I think, 10 years in the future, same as it was 10 years ago. So, I think they've gotten beyond factoring 15. They did build a quantum circuit that could factor 15. Of course, I can factor 15 with this piece of chalk.
Yeah.
That is very much at the flip-flops made out of vacuum tube stage, if that. It feels more like Pascal's adding machine made with gears.
Yeah.
So.
Well, there is also.
I'll worry about that when I can see useful things actually happening. But it's good that NSA is looking at what perfect forward secrecy would mean when the future might include quantum cryptography. That's a good idea.
And there's also the D-Wave, which isn't perfect quantum, but is definitely not quite the
There's all sorts of exciting things that might be happening. And which one of them is actually happening? Not sure. But, into the Wayback Machine. In old school cryptography, there were basically three sorts of things. You had your steganography, your codes, your ciphers, and check all of the above that apply. So with steganography, I don't see any message here. Do you see a message here? So in the Perl community, we have this module called Acme Bleach, which turns your file into a set of spaces and tabs, which form a Bacon cipher for the bits of the characters that are replaced. But the file contains only spaces and tabs, so you open in the editor, you see nothing. That's steganography. The lemon juice, the simplest secret ink in the world. Or you tattoo the message on the scalp of a freshly shaved slave and send them 3 weeks walking distance that way, in which time their hair regrows, and by the time they cross enemy lines, they have a full head of hair again, no suspicion. And when they get to the other general, he shaves their head and reads the message. This is a classic from your Greek history.
You get through.
Hmm?
You might kill them along the way.
Absolutely, but you know the same thing applies to TCP/IP packets and pigeons. It's worth a try. So message in a bottle is sort of steganographic. The classic cryptographic example, attack at dawn, becomes this.
Nothing.
Right. Then you have codes. Here we have a code book. Look at the yellow and green tabs, you will see some pages of codes. And the red tab has instruction to do all of the above. Very bad instructions to do all of the above, but the basic structure of this code book is like the code books of all time. This one was published by Western Union, the Telegram people. And everybody that subscribed to Western Union Telegrams could get a copy. And it didn't count as sending an encrypted message that the government couldn't break because it was encrypted in a code that everybody had.
use this to reduce your telegram charges. The telegram company charged less for a pronounceable word than for garbage. So the code book has pronounceable words. In ancient history, the earliest codes were what are called nomenclators. They have replacements for names, replacements for nouns. The little words, your articles, your prepositions, and things, would be left as is, and you just replace Jerry in the message with Burger King as his code name. And that was a nomenclator. And in the Renaissance, these were big things. And they added a little cipher to it, so, okay, if we don't have the word, we'll spell the letters with code words for the letters. Okay. You attack at dawn might become great jelly at dawn. commercial code books like that one, to be legal, you had to tell the cable company which one you were using, so that the government could decrypt the messages they needed to. So key escrow is not a new concept. It's an evil concept, but it's not new. And they're used for brevity, save cost. But the pink tab shows you how they suggested you could have secrecy too. In addition to the code words, there's a column of code numbers. And if you take the code number and add 10 to the code number and then look up the code number that's at plus 10 and use that code word, you have your own code. You have super enciphered your code. But that's check all of the above, and that's on another slide. Trench codes. If you make a really small one of these books that has everything a platoon sergeant in the frontline trench in World War I needs, attack at dawn, that's one phrase. That's in the book, the whole thing. And you reissue those every week or two, or as soon as you realize that the enemy has captured one, which may be a lot sooner than 2 weeks. But you always have at least one or two spare sets ready to distribute from the backline trenches in case the frontline trenches need them fast. That was a big thing in World War I. Military code books tend to be two-volume code books, or two-part codes. Instead of having the code words and their replacements in the same alphabetical sequence, which makes it much easier for the code breaker to break the code, because they know that attack is going to fall between access and Baluchistan in your code book. If they've figured out those two, they know what's in between them. So a really professional code book randomizes the assignment of code words to regular words, and then you need a two-part English, French, French, English dictionary to look them up. Wouldn't it be so much easier if the French words were alphabetized the same as the English words? Then you could have a one-part French, English dictionary. Well, it doesn't work that way, and it shouldn't work that way in your code book. However, certain idiots like the U.S. State Department continued using one-part code straight up into the beginning of World War II. Much wrong there. Of course, they're the people that Hillary's email server was more secure than. There was a good reason she wasn't using their email server. It was known to be infested by at least one foreign power. For most of the last 15 years. Nobody's proven that hers was. Could have been. But, you know, the State Department unclassified servers have had to be fixed by Department of Transportation personnel because State Department couldn't fix it themselves. And then it had to be fumigated again, and again, and again. Diplomats. For over 100 years, diplomats have not accepted security advice from security professionals because they're too good for it. They didn't accept it in 1903. They didn't accept it in 2003. They're still screwed up. This is not a surprise. Technicians over Department of Transportation, FAA, people like that, they know computer security is a good thing. They have better people in the State Department. State Department didn't go to the military. They don't trust them.
but that I'd accept help from the FAA security guy. So anyway, famous examples of code books. The Americans broke the Japanese naval code, or not Japanese diplomatic code book, during the Washington Naval Conference, where everybody was agreeing to disarm. We were not going to build the next round of battleships. Everybody was going to stand pat on the battleships you've got. You can't build 16-inch guns. The Army was very thankful for that. So the best battleships would be 14-inch guns. And we negotiated a ratio. For every 10 the Americans and the British had, other countries, other major powers, would be allowed 5 or 7 or 9, depending on their pecking order in the great powers league table. And Yardley, the great bridge columnist, decrypted the message that the Foreign Office in Tokyo, told their ambassador to the conference, well, try for 8. If you can't get 8, fall back to 6. And if you can't get 6, 5 is our last offer. And Yardley and his team decrypt this, translate it into English, or have the Navy translate it into English, and then pass it to the State Department negotiators, who are very, very hard. And the Japanese fall back and fall back and accept whatever their lowest offer was. I think it was 5, but don't trust my memory. Read the book. And when the government cut his budget, because gentlemen don't read other gentlemen's mail, when the new Secretary of State came in, he published a book on it. And the Japanese were annoyed. So was the US government. Tried to prosecute him. And he said, hey, my secrecy contract was null and void when you stopped my pet. They've rewritten those contracts. So the State Department Gray Code was so well known, not only among our diplomats, but the other diplomats, that when one of our diplomats in Shanghai retired, he gave his address to the retirement party entirely in Gray Code.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah. And it wasn't just Americans there. So I think it was broken. But we knew a war was coming, so we didn't take it out, because we'd replace it at the last moment. When you choose to replace it, something that you think the enemy might have broken, it is important. So Midway, we broke the Japanese naval code. We weren't sure if this word here meant Midway or not. So in a code that we knew they had broken, because we'd seen messages in another thing that we'd broken, referring to the message that we sent, and we had a low-grade naval thing. We instruct somebody in a low-grade naval thing to send the message, Midway's water purifier is broken. Please send parts. And a message passes in JAN 25B that says, the word that we're not sure if it's Midway or not, water, broken. Since that was a fake message, the only place they could have gotten it was over there. So, yeah. So that then we saw the message that said, there, or we'd already seen the message that said that code word is the target of the big attack with all the carriers coming in. So they did not fall for the feint on Alaska. And instead, the carriers were parked just out of sight of Midway. So that when the Japanese aircraft carriers launched for Midway, then our carriers launched to take out their carriers while their planes were in flight. Who's trapped? So, grape jelly textbook. Not in alphabetical order, all words covered. This, by the way, is how it would be encrypted in the book that's going around the room. The word attack isn't in the book. You could just use the word attack, I suppose. Or you just stick it in the first blank spot after attach, which is the order. And dawn isn't a word in there. But 5 a.m. Thursday has a single code word. Good enough. We'll use that. Ciphers are what we mostly know about. That's where you're going. Take a letter or two or three, replace it with a letter or two or three. Not necessarily one to one there. You know, your Caesar cipher, go three down the alphabet. Rot 13, we all remember that one. The Enigma, Vernum, Solitaire from the book. All ciphers. Now, why does Caesar get precedence? The Hebrew Atlas system is older. Same cipher. And our digital stream ciphers are basically substitution ciphers. Transposition is when you rearrange the deck chairs. This is the scramble on the funny pages in that thing that they used to sell in kiosks by the subway station called the newspaper. One of the puzzles in there was scramble the letters in a phrase, and you have to guess what the scrambled phrase is. That's a transposition cipher if you happen to have a key to unscramble it as opposed to having to guess it. But guess what? If you don't have the key to it, then it's a scramble. People solve those puzzles for fun. Is it as secure as you think? Maybe not. Then a hybrid is when you do all of the cipher pieces without using the other slides. And now some of our digital ciphers, like AES or DES, the so-called Feistel round ciphers, do some substitution, the S boxes, and some transposition, the P or permutation boxes. They're shuffling the bits. And they're shuffling the bits across frequently 8 bytes worth of bits, or more. So it's doing a little of this, a little of that. That's not new. We talk about Bletchley Park as if all they did was Enigma. No, they not only broke Enigma, they broke a whole series of non-Morse code, actual teletype, over-the-air radio teletype, that were grouped into the Tunney class, where there are actually like 4 different models, most of them made by Siemens, not all of them. And those, they had both S boxes and P boxes. They permuted, it was a 5-bit code, because it was the all uppercase teletype, the bad old telegrams. They had a 5-bit code, and they would interleave them as well as invert them. So the simplest substitution, invert or don't invert each of the 5 bits, and then pick one of your, 60 possible permutations of your 5 bits. And the combination of those two with a running key, it was pretty hard to break, but it had just enough regularity that Bletchley Park could break into it. So that's nothing new there, really. We're just adapting it to an 8-bit world with 256-bit keys. And then there's the really hybrid, where you do maybe a little steganography, but definitely mix the ciphers and the codes. So the diplomatic and commercial code books, the code book that's going around the room, which it seems to have stalled at Federico's table, keep it moving, that has a suggestion of using an increment of 10, which is convenient because it'll probably land on the same page. That's a little too convenient. Military use, your additives, as it's called, to superencipher would be an actual 5-digit number, which you do modulo 10 to the 5th. Or you could do it modulo 10 in each column, depends on your system. And you wouldn't use, you might very well not use the same 5-digit number all the way through the message. You might have a string of them that you would repeat through the message. And that's a more military-grade superencipherment. Or you could reorder the code groups as a transposition to make it harder to figure out how the code groups relate to anything. because which code groups are next to which code groups is how you break these things. So if you change the transposition key daily, that protects the book that you have to keep using for several years to pay for it. Substitution ciphers with a jargon phrase book for the important words is one way to strengthen a toy substitution cipher. The KGB and GRU, their military intelligence side in the old Soviet Union, their ciphers really used all of the above. They either used a straddle or vigenère as the basic substitution cipher with a three-step process to derive a key, so it was really scrambled, which is also helpful. They used a separate nomenclator type substitution for the proper words in a message. So the name of your contact, you would just say number 7, and then in a separate message, send 7 equals Jerry Feldman. So they have to intercept both messages, decrypt both messages to find out who the traitor is. Some of their agents had a one-time pad, which was printed on rice paper, rolled up and stuffed into a matchbox and stored in the wastebasket. So you're not likely to find it. When they did transposition, they did double transposition, not just once, they do it a second time. And instead of just putting in a rectangle, they'd draw funny-shaped areas on it, where they'd fill in everything outside the funny-shaped area, then fill in the funny-shaped area, so that that was a so-called void, which makes it a lot harder to just factorize it, line it up, anagram it, hope it works. They also use micro dots and or secret ink and the hollow nickel for steganography. Literally, all of the above. If we hadn't had a traitor explain this to us, never would have gotten it. But, you know, when you catch the guy with the one-time pad in his wastebasket, suddenly he decides to get reasonable. That firing squad doesn't look so good. He'd rather get exchanged for somebody on the bridge. So tonight we're talking about those transposition ciphers. The Greeks who invented steganography and gave it a name also invented transposition ciphers. The Skittily rhymes with Italy, sort of. Take a perfectly cylindrical staff, wrap a piece of leather, birch bark, long strip of paper around it, write your message in a row across, turn it like a corn cob, write the next line of the message, and then unroll it. Only somebody with the same size stick can read the message. Or so they thought. Well, bullshit. Once I know it's a Skittily, I can try every third letter, I can try every fourth letter, I can try every fifth letter until I find out what diameter it is. Your stick has got to be an integer number of letters around. How many choices are there? How long is your message? Well, it's not as hard to break as they thought. But they thought it was brilliant. They were fighting people who would have thought it was brilliant. They hadn't gotten around to thinking, ooh, it has to be an integer. Didn't know there were things besides integers. Well, yeah, they know
value of number theory.
Hmm?
The strategic value of number theory.
Absolutely. On the lower right is what's called a grill, with an extra E because it's French. What you do is you cut out one quarter of the squares, subsquares, in a big square, in such a way that if you turn it 4 times and color in the squares that are open on each of the 4 settings, you've colored all of the underlying squares exactly once. So you write your message in the open squares, and then turn it, write the next set of letters, turn it, write the next set, and you've scrambled your message. And you think, only somebody that has this can read it. Well, maybe. If there's a Q in there, then the next letter is one of the two U's.
The rail fence, you, give me a little eraser, I won't hurt you. You write your message alternating in this pattern and then copy it off across. So it's like a zigzag fence in the old west, a rail fence. That is pretty simple to break, but if you're using it, if that's the second step after bifid substitution, which is to say a substitution which replaces one letter with two symbols, be they letters or numbers or smiley faces, this breaks up the pairs and makes it a good bit harder to solve. So it's not something you want to use on its own. You know, if you use a rail fence transposition just with English, you know, the Q and the U want to go together. That's one of the first things somebody's going to try to see if you did it. So you wouldn't do it by itself, but as a second step to increase the weight of another pencil and paper cipher, yeah, it'd be good. But there are no pencil and paper ciphers that'll stand up to somebody with even a cheap computer. So don't try it.
Are you sure it would survive even the hotel doorknob computer?
Right.
That's
exactly.
Kind of beyond.
Exactly. Solitaire is like the only pencil and paper cipher that has a chance of standing up to a rigorous opponent, and your chances of executing solitaire correctly are about as likely as you're getting correct typing of all the characters of an 11-word passphrase to get your 100 bits of entropy correctly the first time. If you're going to require I type an 11-word passphrase to unlock my something or other, because that's the minimum professional level, you better give me more than three tries before you destroy the world. My typing's not that good, and neither is yours. So the classic transposition is columnar, where you write the message in rows and take it out in columns, and maybe you do something more obvious, something less obvious than take out the first column, second column, third column, fourth column. Probably want to take them out in a different order, so you have a key to A, how big is the square? It's not a square. How big is the rectangle? And which columns to read out, and maybe you read some of the columns backwards or something. Double transposition is you do this twice. Mentioned that a moment ago. You put them in the columns, put them in the rows, take them out in the columns in some order, then put it into a different size rectangle in rows and take out different columns again. That is tough to break. Doable if you have a lot of messages in the same key, but it's tough to break. And it's also tough to execute. Good chance of making a mistake. Well, we'll come back to that. There are variations. Disrupted voids, we mentioned with KGB. The Miskowski variation, if your keyword has repeated letters like potato and tomato, instead of having the two O's have sequential column numbers for readout, they have the equal column numbers, and you read what's under the O, each O in the first row out, and then the second out, then the third in each out, to keep it from being perfectly rectangular. Effectively, the O columns are merged and become double high columns, having been interleaved. So it mixes things up. It also gives you more room for mistakes doing this with pencil. And the real problem is if it's too hard to do right the first time, the person sending the message is going to be asked by the person receiving the message, what the heck did you do? Send it again. And sending it again is the biggest sin in cryptography. You're better off sending it in the clear in the first place than sending it twice under two different keys. That's just a gift.
So actually, speaking of with ransomware, I heard a really clever way if you actually get hit in a little insurance policy, 10 meg file, 10 meg clear text file, name it whatever you want, dot docx, dot this, dot that, dot dat, dot everything. Thing gets hit, you know the clear text file, you have it, and you now, your brute force space now went from a very large area to a very, and
known clear text does help.
And even if you, which is why I'm surprised that like a crypt triple X 3 hasn't been broken yet, because I mean, all you have to do is just take it, stick it on a group of files that you know all the clear text. That keeps shrinking your key space down.
Absolutely. So disadvantages. There's not a lot of key space. You've got, how wide is the table? How deep is the table is sort of controlled by the length of the message divided by the columns. That's not really a free variable. And then you've got the order you read the columns out, and maybe double that by whether they're up or down. Unless you go into the voids or the tomato stuff, you've just run out of key bits. There aren't a lot of key bits there. So this was great for slowing people down without computers, but the key space is so small you can brute force it with a computer today. Give me all permutations of these letters. Let's see which ones look like English. And that the old way of solving these was by multiple anagramming. If you have two things you thought were in the same key, you want put the two messages on a wide sheet of paper, and instead of slicing it down the middle to make two messages, you slice it into little columns of two or five or however many messages you have that were the same size on the same day. And then you try to arrange them such that words are forming on one line to see if words form on the other lines. And when you've got a word on all the lines, or fractions of two words on all the lines at once, those are probably right. And then you extend them on the right and extend them on the left by picking up little slips of paper that match. It's like solving the scramble in the comic pages, except doing five of them simultaneously. Like simultaneous chess, except in this case, simultaneous is easier. And the computer is even better at that. So, you know, not something anybody wants to do anymore. But the key disadvantages of substitution sort of become an advantage here. You have to have an idea of a probable word or a lot of instances in order to get an entry into this. If you don't know what language it is, if you don't know what words are likely, you're going to get nowhere. It's not going to tell you much about it. You will be able to get a sense as to whether it's French or German or English, because the percentage of E's versus I's, and that sort of thing will suggest that it's probably transposed English as opposed to transposed French, as opposed to transposition of some substitution. But it's just, you've got to have some hint to get in there. Of course, you always have some hint. The word "the" is going to be in there. That's a start. If you try all the T's with all the H's on the first row and see what if any of the second row looks vaguely pronounceable, it's a start. So, that mitigation isn't that much help. So, backwards into history, the U.S. Military Telegram Company was set up as a quasi-military, quasi-commercial entity to run a telegraph office in the old Executive Office Building, which is a short walk from the Oval Office, downtown Washington, and a railroad executive who was friends of Lincoln from Chicago sent
Lincoln a couple of his best telegraphic operators, and they recruited people to from railroad telegraph lines to go and string copper for the signal corps, and signal corps had some copper stringers, and they were putting up copper telegraph lines wherever the army went. So the generals could, the top generals could communicate with the Secretary of War and President Lincoln. And President Lincoln spent much of his day hanging out in the telegraphy office. It became the war room because it's where the fresh intelligence was. He would watch them decipher the messages from his generals. And there is a citizen data, a citizen science project trying to transcribe Lincoln's war telegrams. They say it's decoding the Civil War. Well, basically, they've got the original and the encoded versions of almost all the messages. So you're not actually going to get to do any decoding. What they're asking you to do is read the pretty copper plate rating of those weird old people that used dipping pens and try to translate that into ASCII, please. That's what they're asking the citizen scientists to do. Okay, I could do that, but I don't want to. But it's a good thing. If that's your thing, please go and help them. And let's see. So here's an example. What's next news? I, the prayers. I, to while coming star, what you, mean dispatch zebra, I, you, spirit there, understanding any if piloted your offer there, such of any, and have, was I, to Emma, never seen of, no, Toby, Zodiac. That's nonsense. On the other hand, those are not, that doesn't feel like the sort of words that would be a code. That really feels like somebody's done a transposition of words, not a transposition of numbers. And indeed, that's exactly what it is. Those are the words of the message rearranged according to a key. This was a cheap single part code, which is just what we had in this book. That was a single part code. So that the code words are in alphabetical sequence with their replacements, at least section-wise. But they had homophony in terms of having multiple replacements for the same important word. And they also recommended punning homophony so that you would say Anna Police if you needed to say Annapolis and there didn't happen to be a keyword replacement, or what they called an arbitrary replacement for the city Annapolis because it wasn't in the last code, maybe we'll add it to the next one. So instead of sticking Annapolis right in the message, which makes it obvious to somebody that, hey, this might be about Annapolis, you have Anna and police in different portions of the message after it's been scrambled, and that doesn't shout it's about Annapolis, but you haven't spelled it out letter by letter, which would make it subject to a simple substitution crack. So they used the code words and then super encrypted by a transposition, what's called a root cipher, which is to say it was the words were written in and then read out by columns, sometimes up, sometimes down. They also had special code words that indicated the size and the route tucked into the message. And they also marked at the end of each column to show you that you'd gotten it right and where the ends of the columns were. So how would we decrypt this? Tucked in the message, there was a check of what number of 123, which is not the size of the message received, it's the size of the original message. So that helps you put Annapolis back together. You know you've got too many words. You've got 125, and it's supposed to be 123. So Annapolis collapses and something else collapses. Now it says to Emmerich from Ecker. It doesn't say to the president or from the president. The encrypted message is from the head of this telegraphy office to the head of that telegraphy office. So it's the equivalent of saying from Washington to London on a diplomatic circuit today. You don't address it to the recipient, you address it to the office. And inside, in the encrypted section, it says who is really to and from. What's next news, which was just before the prayers of I-2, those are blinds, which in the current pamphlet translates what's is 10 columns and however many rows you need. And next and news have numeric values 2 and 9, which you add up is 11, which predicts how many needed lines there are. It should work out. And the combination of these also gives you a ciphering route of column 6, column 10, up column 1, 8, up column 2, 4, up 7, 3, up 5, 9. And if you, well, if you want to understand the programming and the unroute, come to Boston ProMongers where I'll discuss the code here. So this is the pictorial version of that route as given in the Citizen Science Project, Decoding the Civil War, that shows the ups and downs that we're going to use and shows the row of null words at the bottom of each column. So first thing we do is take off the null words and then break it into columns. So the so we've divided it, then pull off the column checks. The column checks mean your never remains over not census plenty and down. They meant nothing, so we can just throw them away.
What were the column checks again? Can you back up one?
They were words that we ripped off the end of the columns. Mean is at the end of the column one. And so we just rip it off there because we're going to throw it away. And then if we, any row that had a negative route, or any column that had a negative route, we reverse left to right all of the words. And then readjust the order, and it starts to make sense, except it doesn't. So now we have to use the translation of important words, or arbitraries, as Team Lincoln said. Abe out is one of the homophone talkarounds. That's the word about, but it's not. And withdraw the offer is a single word, but it's been blown up into two. And inform me has been blown up into two. There are also some longhand typos. Aw. And the nice scripty font isn't on this computer. Oh well. I wanted this to be in a script font with longhand typos. Oh well. But the two was a typo. Somebody scribbled and didn't read their own scribble correctly. I'm sorry, if you learned fancy copperplate handwriting in grammar school, you should be able to read it. Well, he copied it wrong. He copied a do as a to, and he copied a hearing as a bearing. And that for a what and a my for a back. Those are the typos I make with my 51-hand keyboard.
And then the words that came after the signature of signed President of the U.S., which were also arbitraries, why don't you say what you piloted? Those were the nulls to pad out the rectangle. But since they come after the check count and after the signature, the person decrypting it knows not to pass those on in the decrypted copy. That was a personal message for him from the guy who encrypted it. This is an operator-operator out-of-band back channel. So, what did you pilot? Well, it's not an airplane because this is 1863. So, I guess they've got either a boat or a balloon. Probably a boat. I don't know.
So, a bit early subliminal channel.
Yes. Yes. So that was Lincoln's top level cipher for communicating with his generals, and in a periodic period they redistributed a set of cards that would be the new cipher that would go into effect at the start of the month, that changed the arbitraries, changed the code words mapping to rectangles and routes, and so that you'd never build up a lot of them. Now, what's the chance the Confederates could have broken this? Well, if they had really sharp people, of the sort of people that were working for the secret police in the European Renaissance, no problem. This was below state-of-the-art in Europe a couple hundred years before this war. But Europe had forgotten it. Europe had built better forts, but they'd forgotten some of their best cryptography. The blog from the people running the Citizen Science Project say they think it was never broken by the Confederates. Well, we didn't get a full set of archives from the Confederates because they got chased around and burned things, and we only have the winner's version of history. So we don't know, but it's likely true. What we've seen of Confederate cryptography was even worse. The rebels used the simple polyalphabetic Vigenère with a single key for most of the war. They didn't change it weekly. They didn't change it monthly. They didn't even change it yearly. Manchester Bluff, that was their key. With a heck of a lot of E's in it, that's not a good key. Vigenère was a good cipher, but around the same time, a really smart Englishman had cracked it. You may have heard of him, Babbage. He cracked the Vigenère. Didn't publish. Found it in his papers after he died. He couldn't have been the only one. So did they have the intel staff to do this? No. Did they have the spies to go out and tap the Union telegraph and copy down the messages? Sometimes. To crack this, you need to copy every damn message. You need to have somebody on a tapping line coming out of the executive office building in all directions. Which is why this kind of cipher, when they tried using it in World War I with radio and with trench telegraphs, was a problem. Because with trench telegraphs or trench telephones, you could use induction pickup from the other side of the battlefield. With so little electronics around there, you set out dirt antennas and you can measure the biggest signal in the county. Can't do that today because everybody's got a phone. Can do it then. So once we went to a compact battlefield in Sitz Creek with telegraphy and a lot of radio, just Morse code radio, but radio, the enemy could get all the messages. They could get a depth. They could break it. They couldn't do that here because he was talking to this general once or twice a day on that wire, and this general once or twice a day on that wire. Hard to get all the messages with cavalry running around trying not to get killed. They did some of that, and they got some low-level ciphers broken. The both sides broke each other's wigwag codes, where they're doing visual distance signaling with the flags like Boy Scouts. And they started from the same position, because guess what? All the generals had gone to West Point together, both sides. Because it used to be one army, and then it split. So they all had the same training. They just changed which Whigs and Wags were A or E. So they had a simple substitution cipher difference between your Whig Wags and my Whig Wags. That's easy to break. I could break it in eighth grade. I should have been able to break it in third grade after I read that little book. Both sides broke both, and the Yankees took advantage of it. They got one of their wigwag people decrypted a message where the Confederate wigwags on the other side of the river were talking about the message that they'd already broken from the Yankee wigwags. So he sent the message that they've already broken our code by courier, not by wigwag, to the rear. And they say, okay, we are not going to change our code until we've made them swallow a couple of fake messages. And so they tell them they're doing a feint this away to hit Lee's son Fitz's cavalry when he's alone. And so all the cavalry goes running off that way to protect him and catch the Yankees in a trap because they don't know we're all going to be there. And instead, the Yankees cross the river to where there are no cavalry and kick butt. And then they change their code. So breaking is possible, but difficult, particularly with the skills that were in America then. But you know, in the Renaissance, when they had a black chamber where all the mail, including the diplomatic pouches, leaving the capital of Austria, had to go through the black chamber. Everything was unsealed, copied, and then carefully resealed. They would take an impression of the seal with a different wax and reseal it. So you couldn't tell it had been tampered with. And they copied every letter leaving the capital. If it was in cipher, they broke the cipher. If it was in code, they kept a book and slowly figured out which word was which. Same thing in Renaissance France. These guys were good. That was a lost art until World War I, really. So, already said that. So, aids in breaking, Kirchhoff's principle, only the keys are unknown. Assume the enemy knows your method. And just the secret key bits are secret. Because A, a traitor, B, if you look at the message, yeah, that really smells like word transposition. It doesn't smell like anything else. It's obvious. The blind words are sort of scary to me. If you don't have I haven't seen enough of the information on that system to know whether they had enough variants, if there were different routes for 10 columns, there were several code words for 10 columns with different routes that they could mix and match. That would be good. I don't know if they did. This goes into how you break a code book. Details. Boring. Many good books you can read about it. Second historic example, World War I. I just said. This came in its own in World War I.
Wait a minute, that's a historic example, not a historic example.
Typos help in breaking cryptography too. Not really year 100, it's year 98, because even though the Battle of the Somme was underway 100 years ago today, this is from 1918, not 1916. This is a German near front general officer level cipher, so your mobile army command posts are radioing each other, trying to dodge out of the way because, you know,
some idiot's throwing grenades over the side of an airplane, so try to hide. And they're trying to do a breakout. They want to do a big breakout attack, so they're coordinating. The cipher is called ADFGVX because those are the only letters that were sent on the radio. Why, you might ask? Well, one problem when you're sending code words that are random letter garbage, as opposed to nice pronounceable ones like this book has, is the Morse code operator hearing them. You can hear syllables as they're going by fast. Letters that are taken from an encipherment, that's hard. So pick six letters which sound very different to the ear in Morse code, and use only those six. You can distinguish between them faster on a noisy circuit, better than if you try to use all 26 or 36. So they've started out with just five of the letters and 25 letters of the alphabet. A lot of European alphabets don't have a 26 letter, so that's okay. Or you just double two of them. But they found that spelling out numbers was painful. So they added a fifth letter, the V, a sixth letter, the V, and stuck in the digits. When no longer do you have to have a shift to go into numeric or have spell out 9, 9, 9, 9. This is good. So, and there's even a little bit of Morse code there for you. Where's my mouse? Hello, mouse. There we go. Morse code. Those are the letters on the top row. So, but if they just sent the two letters that replace one letter, so that N is replaced by AA, B is replaced by DF. If you just send those letters in order like that, all somebody has to do is guess, okay, he's only sending six different letters. They must be two letters mapped from one letter. Then they just break them in twos, and it's back to a simple substitution, you're broke. So, to protect it, you write them out in a row, read them out in columns. Hey, we just saw that in the Civil War. They did not put nulls in the last row, so the columns are of two different lengths. That's what you call a ragged transposition. They did recommend that don't be too good with your spelling. Go ahead and use misspelled words. And don't always use the phrase the same way. Be a little imaginative in your phrasing, which makes it harder to look for probable words in anagram. Still, it was broken mostly by Georges Pinvet. One Frenchman working mostly on, he had some help. There was another guy on the intelligence staff who helped him out when the paper got high, and there's possibility that an American who was posted by mistake to intelligence to head the cipher department in France. He had the same last name as a noted cipher expert. He took the 1 month introduction to cipher class and then was shipped to France. And when he got there, oh, you're the new cipher guy? Excellent, you're in charge. Because they thought he was the other guy. But he was a natural, so he worked out. I'm not sure if this is the cipher that he worked with the French on when they were anticipating a big offensive. He worked on one of them with possibly this guy or possibly the guy at the next echelon up. But there may have been American involvement there. Anyway, so immediately he notices there are only five letters involved. Okay, so it's got to be a bifid, which is to say a 1-to-2 expansion matrix sort of thing. The frequency distribution varied from day to day, therefore they're using daily keys. That suggests that maybe the transposition key changes daily also, so that we're going to have to, in order to get a depth, we have to get multiple messages from the same day. So that's what he did. He had all the radio intercept stations send him any message that only consisted of those letters. It took a while to get a day with enough messages to actually break it, but there's a flurry of messages just before an attack. That's when you need it. The first time he broke it, he didn't get the break until after the attack had already happened. But once he knew the pattern of how to break it, the next time was faster. If we say that it was on the order of a dozen keys that he managed to recover and read all the traffic from that day, you'd think, that's not very good. But it was over half of the messages sent in the system, because it was the hot days. So the first thing to do in breaking one of these transposition systems is figure out the shape of the rectangle. If it's not ragged, if it's a perfect rectangle, hey, you're factoring a small number. How many ways are there to factor 15? We discussed that with quantum cryptography a little earlier. If the dummies don't, if the dumb generals or ambassadors don't listen to their crypto techs and go ahead and always start the message the same way, that is a gift to the people listening in. They will look for it. And once they have that phrase, the rest of it just knits together nicely. Pamba had to figure out which were the long columns and which were the short columns. After the war, they found a general purpose way of doing this, which was classified until fairly recently. Luckily, the 1930s textbooks have been recently declassified. Fun reading if you like early 30th century technical writing. If you get two messages that are slightly different, one's a little longer, but are sent at the same time from the same station to two other stations, so you're using your signals intelligence of who talks to whom to tell you something about what's in the message, then you guess that maybe they're the same message, but with a different inside address, so that one of them is going to the commander of a division with a small number in its name, and the other is going to a division with a long number in its name. That's how he broke in before they stuck the numerals into the table. The frequency analysis that you use in a substitution cipher can be used here with the bifid components. The A's and X's are going to be more or less frequent on the left-hand coordinate or the top coordinate, depending where the hot letters are in the table. So you may be able to sort out the lefty columns versus the top columns once you've got it sorted into columns. That greatly reduces your anagramming search space. Oops. So the reality is that using the small number of letters, such that there are only 36 combinations, actually made it easier in certain ways. So once you've cracked the key on a few messages, then all the rest of the messages in that day can be read trivially. As it happened, Pamba, who was a major by the end of the war, and the German cryptographer who invented the system, who started also as a lieutenant but became a colonel, both survived the war and were at a conference discussing such matters after the war together. And in the discussion, yes,
Colonel Nebel knew that double transposition would have been much harder to break. And he also knew that the cipher clerks in the front line wouldn't have gotten it right. That have messed up more often than they got it right, which would have been messing up, would have been a bigger gift to Panvant than the cost to him of when it was done right, he couldn't break it. using the same letters for the row and the column labels is what is called a complication illusoire, illusory complication. Since we can use the frequency analysis to tell us which columns are left labeled versus top labels, they're really not confusing us. They're just the person inventing the system feels it's helping them. The keeping the beginning at the beginning, it would have been much more secure if they'd used what's known as the Russian copulation or Russian copula, where you pick an arbitrary point in the message, rip it apart, and swap it, like doing a cut of a card deck. Then the stereotyped beginning of the message is buried in the middle. This was standard in KGB work, hence the name. But many other systems would benefit from doing it. If it's obvious where the break is once you've deciphered it, you don't even need any indicator to say where you broke it. Sometimes you need an indicator if it's not obvious. The
starts to be our comrade.
Yes. Exactly. So many a system has been invented by somebody who can't think of a way to break it. On the other hand, they love it, so they aren't thinking hard enough.
Well, yeah, I mean, I can't remember who said it, but any system, anybody can devise a system so diabolical that they cannot break it.
Right. It's harder to come up with something that a truly diabolical person can't.
Well, that's what peer review
is. That's what peer review is for. And it really helps if the peer review is by somebody that the rest of the world acknowledges is a true peer and not just your peer.
My sister thinks I'm awesome.
Yeah, thus endeth history. Here's our PGP how-to. Yes, somebody posted a PGP primer in emoji. And it fit in 140 characters.
Sweet.
That's the whole point of emoji, isn't it? To kind of like do crunch down.
Part of emoji is Huffman encoding emotions.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
That and overemphasizing how much you're laughing at something.
There could be a touch of that.
That's like years.
Well, like
maybe you're like brain is laughing. You talk to laughing.
There's
a lot of laughing.
Yeah,
it's like someone insults you and then they
lost your spine.
And they have like five or six with the tears. She's like, right. Needs more JPEG.
Like explore the compression space.
This is a sample of the actual text of one of the Abraham Lincoln clear texts. And here is the code, a workbook doing the transposition. Actually saved a workbook. Here's the sheet for the code of the month. Number